Welcome to the Pride of Detroit post-game podcast. My name is Jeremy Reisman. I am the editor-in-chief of Pride of Detroit. I will be your adequate host this week as Chris has some time off with some family. With me to break down a football game, I guess it can technically be called a football game, is the Rock God, Ryan Matthews. At Ryan_POD. Ryan, welcome. We're going to have to somehow tackle this one, just you and I.
I definitely feel less good about the Rock God intro after watching the Woodstock 99 documentary. And I'm not trying to throw this thing off the rails already to begin with, but I'm just saying.
It sounds like you are.
Well, you know, it's... I'm so glad that you described this as a football game because it was. There was the snapping from the center to the quarterback and teams play. My gosh. Yeah, it's in the books. It's done. The Lions are out of Denver.
Yeah. And honestly, I feel like we're going to try to turn the page on this one as quick as possible. And I feel like the Lions are
little
probably
Bob Seger.
No. The Metallica version.
Okay. Metallica's cover of a classic Detroit song.
Better version. Lions lose 38-10 to the Denver Broncos in a game that was close until it very much was not anymore. It did feel like the Lions were working their way back into that game after a pretty horrendous start. And then the second half started and there was nothing, pretty much nothing that went well in the second half. We're going to break it all down. But I guess Ryan, you know, we previewed this game on Thursday. We knew with all the flu stuff going on, and at that point, we only kind of knew the tip of the iceberg stuff because two more key players got put on COVID on Friday after we recorded that podcast, and then two more were put on COVID on Saturday morning. So, all things considered, was there anything that really surprised you that happened on Sunday or disappointed you, I guess? Or was it just shrug your shoulders, turn the page?
I can't say it was disappointing, but it was deflating to see the way that the Denver Broncos came out and just set the tone for this game, right? I mean, you look at the way that the Denver Broncos just ran the football ad nauseum. I mean, 39 attempts for 184 yards, 3 touchdowns on the ground. And the longest runs of the day by the Denver Broncos were 16 yards by Melvin Gordon and 9 yards by Javonte Williams. I mean, it wasn't like it was... You know, the Broncos ripped off a couple of long runs and that was that was the nail in the coffin for the Lions. It was death by 1,000 carries.
Yeah. Just 8 yards at a time. 8 yard chunk, 8 yard chunk, 8 yard chunk.
I would be hard pressed to believe that the Denver Broncos were ever off schedule in terms of their drives in this game. I mean, there was maybe a time or two where the Denver Broncos weren't, you know, keeping up with where their offense needed to be. And it was, you know, it was a perfect game plan. Give Vic Fangio credit. You know, he almost took, you know, this game was very reminiscent, I think, of what the Eagles did to the Lions, but the Lions just had a little bit more, to call it pizzazz, just because it was one really fun touchdown play that the Lions ran to Khalif Raymond. But really it was a little bit more offense. You know, the Lions were able to put together in this one, but this one was pretty reminiscent of that Eagles game from before the bye week.
Yeah, I can definitely see that. And obviously I think the game plan, like you said, from the Broncos was smart because the Lions are just hurting up the middle of that defense. You know, Levi Onwuzurike and Aleem McNeil did end up playing in this game despite dealing with the flu and not practicing all week. But the linebacking core was devastated and even more devastated once Alex Anzalone left after the second drive of the game. The safeties were not playing particularly well in this game and obviously missing Tracy Walker, a guy who can, you know, lay on some pretty big hits and limit some runs in this. They certainly would have benefited from someone like Tracy Walker being out there in this game. And so, yeah, it felt like I don't know. Let's talk about the defense first, because I think that was one of their worst performances of the year. And you can probably excuse a lot of it, right? Like, you've got nobody on the edges in this game. You've got was Austin Bryant? I don't think Austin Bryant was. I don't remember seeing him at all in this game. But I honestly, like, did you see anybody from the edges in this game? Like, Charles Harris played. I'm pretty sure of that. And then, you know, you're talking about guys like Jesse Lemonnier and just, you know, nothing coming from the edges. You got the defensive interior didn't play horrible in this game. You know, there were times in which they were able to get to Melvin Gordon in the backfield. But for the most part, you know, they didn't do great. Levi, I saw, got pushed out of, you know, some lanes a couple times in this game. And then, yeah, second level. Mm-hmm. Like, I know Josh Woods finishes with, what, 13 tackles in this game, but he did not play well. He missed probably another five. He was out of position several times. And then, you know, even Derek Barnes, you know, a guy that a lot of people are hopeful for, got exposed in coverage a couple times and didn't look particularly good in this game. And then, yeah, like I mentioned, the safety play is just rough. And you put it all together and, you know, outside of that second quarter where it looked like they had maybe started to get things together and forced Teddy Bridgewater to throw the ball, which he wasn't particularly great at in this game, it just looked hopeless, really. Like, I mean, how many times did the Broncos punt in this game? Technically three times, apparently. Sam Martin, old friend, only had a light day today. But to me, I don't know what you can build off of from that defensive performance, because I can't really point at a single person and be like, you had a pretty good game.
Yeah, you know, I think the thing that was most concerning about the Lions' run defense in this game is that there wasn't anybody attacking the point of rush. You know what I mean? It didn't seem like there was anybody getting, you know, at least arms or hands or anything on a running back at the point at which they were trying to make the hole. It seemed like, to take this back to like a Madden example, like when you're playing on like pro level, it seems like you have so much space to run, especially off the edges. It's like, just bounce everything outside, right. Just bounce everything outside. And the Broncos were just able to manipulate the point of attack at which, you know, like you said, to start things off, it was like 6, 7, 8 yards, chunk, 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 chunk. And the Broncos were able to get everything they wanted to on the ground, to the point where, you know, Teddy Bridgewater didn't have to be exceptional. He didn't even have to be good. No. He was pretty replacement level. Like, Drew Lock could have played in this game and the result is still the same.
Yeah.
Like, I don't think Teddy Bridgewater really makes too much of an impact in this game.
Didn't they run like 12 out of the first 15 plays in this game? And then once they got away from it, that's kind of when the Lions came back.
That's when
they
ran into trouble. Yeah.
If they would have just kept that game plan for all four quarters, maybe this game is even worse. But sorry, I'll let you finish your point there.
No, I mean, yeah, you look at the first two drives that the Broncos had, 11 plays for 75 yards, touchdown, 12 plays, 74 yards, a touchdown. Yeah. You know, those two drives take up over 12 minutes, and then it's punt, punt, field goal. That they were able to get at the end of the first half. And, you know, the Lions, to be down 17-10 at halftime felt like a win for the Lions. It felt like, hey, you know what, with the way that the Broncos started and the way that they've regressed and the way that the Lions, they stayed attacking, and it didn't seem like I can't say that the Lions gave up. You know, you look at, I think the drive that was so emblematic is, you know, the Lions are down 31-10, a 16 play drive, 71 yards, that just results in nothing.
Yeah.
That just results in absolutely nothing. And I think, and it was so close to not even having a chance to be in the end zone with the Godwin Igwebuke, what, you know, ended up not being a second fumble for him. But, you know, that's where the Lions season is. 16 plays, 70 some odd yards, a converted safety to running back almost fumbles that possession away, and a tight end whose name I literally cannot even recall.
Shane Zylstra.
There you go. On a clean pocket where Jared Goff had all the time to throw and decided to fade away.
Yep.
Fadeaway. Very reminiscent of like Allen Iverson just fading away for no reason, even though he's got tons of space.
You missed the best play on that drive. Second down. Jared Goff back to pass. Oh no, he's not back to pass. He's on his back because he got stepped on by Halapuli Vaiti. Yeah, I mean, that drive was pretty ridiculous. And I mean, it goes to show you just like this team is not currently built to play from behind. And no. They immediately got behind 14 points. And, you know, since it was the first quarter, they could kind of stick with their game plan early. And, you know, they were still running the ball pretty effectively in that second quarter. And they were able to move the ball effectively.
Netflix.
Yes.
Yeah.
Like the Lions offense, when it was a game, they were doing fine. When they are down 21, 28 points, like the ball has to be in Jared Goff's hands. And that's not good for anybody. And it's more proof. I think maybe this is kind of a slamming down to reality. Not that Jared Goff is a horrible quarterback, but he's not someone that can get you back into a game. He just isn't. Like, we haven't seen that since week one against the 49ers. Because it doesn't happen. Like, he just isn't capable of doing it.
Yeah. NFC Offensive Player of the Week, Jared Goff, really showed his colors in this one.
That's right. We have two more days to call him that.
We do, because unfortunately, I don't think he's going to repeat as NFC Offensive Player of the Week. But, Jeremy, I think what was most sobering about this game was what was that exactly? It was Jared Goff, and it was his performance. And because, I mean, at the end of the day, you even look at the one touchdown that the Lions scored, like that was all play design. Like, what an incredible play design to have cool. Khalif Raymond run all the way opposite of where he ends up being. I mean, what a gassing play for a player to run halfway across the field and then run halfway back across the field with the football, you know, eventually in his hands to score a touchdown. You know, that comes back to play design. And there just isn't much that Jared Goff adds to this offense. You know, it seems like Jared Goff just subtracts. And that's what's that's what's ultimately frustrating. And to take this back to the defense, because I know that's what we're focusing on right now. You know, it's just more bad beats and more bad breaks, and seeing what happened to Jerry Jacobs today was, man, you want to talk about deflating,
right?
You know, just watching the replay, which was so terrible. And, you know, you want to hope the best for him, but after watching that replay, you can only think, you know, the worst possible outcome from that. And it's December 12th, Jeremy.
Yeah.
It's December 12th. So you're talking about a guy, even if a lot of Lions fans are already thinking about next season, right?
Yeah.
A play to happen this late in the season for a guy like that, I hope it's not as serious as it looks, but what a tough break that happens right at the beginning of the game.
Yeah.
Right from the onset. And like you said, Alex Anzalone, he deals with injuries. And then it was just the whole week leading into this.
Yeah.
In terms of the flu outbreak and injuries and does TJ Hockenson make does he make a difference in this game? Maybe. Does DeAndre Swift make a difference in this game? Maybe. I who knows? But
it sucks.
Damn this season.
It sucks, man. Like, the thing that sucks most is we all went into the season knowing it was going to be bad. We all went to the season with one goal. Like, let's see the young guys play. Let's see them get better. We were immediately robbed of Jeff Okuda doing that. We were immediately robbed of Ifeatu Melifonwu doing that. And again, now, like, when he's finally healthy, of course, COVID hits him. Jerry Jacobs steps
Okwara.
Romeo Okwara. I mean, so many young players this year are hurt or limited or whatever, and it's frustrating as hell. Thankfully, Penei Sewell has been balling out as much as he had, even fighting through a shoulder injury that is clearly still impacting him. Actually, you know, most of the rookie class in general is playing and playing decently well, so that's something to hang your hat on. But
Ali McNeil with his first sack.
Exactly. But, like, yeah, to go back to Jerry Jacobs, man, like, you know, you don't want to speculate too much on an injury, but, you know, David J. Chow, the former Chargers doctor, said, you know, looks like an ACL, MCL situation. Not going to call it a tear yet, but Campbell already, you know, he's talking right now as we're recording this, but says, you know, doesn't look good, but we'll know more tomorrow. And, yeah, it's just like, now what? Like, We can only dig into this undrafted free agent hole so far before we have to, like, there's just, like, not a sixth guy down there that's going to be able to do something interesting. So, I mean, you hope that Melifonwu comes back from the reserve COVID sometime soon, but since he was placed on the list, what was it? Was he a Friday or Saturday one? He was a Saturday one, right?
Who was that again?
Melifonwu. I think he was placed there Saturday, which means...
Yes, it was late.
I mean, if you've been following most of these, you know, players placed on reserve COVID, whether they're vaccinated or not, it usually takes at least a week to get back from them. So could miss him next week against the Cardinals, which mean, like, I don't know what you do. Do you trot? I mean, they put Roby Coleman out there this week, which he's more of a nickel, but you don't have outside corners at this point. So I guess go out and try. And he wasn't particularly great. Picks up that pass interference, which I thought was a little weak, and it certainly was an uncatchable pass, but apparently that stipulation doesn't exist anymore, or refs just never call it. But I mean, that was kind of the least of the problems today, because like you said, Bridgewater didn't really have to do anything, but it's just emotionally deflating to see one of the better stories of this Lions team in 2021 go down towards the end of the season. And now you got four more games left. Is that it? Where you're just like, well, who do I have to look forward to now?
Well, but I think that's the thing, Jeremy, is that that was really one of the only things about the defense that was like, hey, the Lions have this guy named Jerry Jacobs, and he might be a legit cornerback.
Yeah,
he might be a guy that figures into their future, an undrafted free agent who has stepped up and performed when, you know, he was on the cutting room floor. Like, right. He was a guy who a lot of people didn't expect to be on this roster. And then that gets taken away. And yeah, it's just tough for this roster, you know, and I think, you know, looking at where they are right now, right? 11-1 or 11-1.
1-1-1.
There's a lot of ones.
Yes.
1-1-1 and 1. Looking at where they are right now, I think you just want the younger guys to be healthy. Like, you want Levi to be healthy, you want Aleem to be healthy, you want Penei Sewell to get through the rest of the season and be healthy. Not to the point where you need to, you know, be overly cautious and, you know, sit these guys, because they still need reps and they still need to play, because that's where the season started, right? That's where we were excited to see Jeff Okuda, and we were excited to get Romeo Okwara out there. We were excited to see Ifeatu Melifonwu before he went on IR. We were excited to see all those guys get reps and get playing time. And even though the Lions weren't going to be very good, they were going to get an opportunity to see these young guys play in those situations. And they've been robbed of that so far. So it's not something that you want to take away from what makes these Lions games watchable, right? Yeah. Because at the end of the day, that's what makes them watchable, is seeing the young players get an opportunity to perform and play. And that's where you hope the rest of the season goes, is that it's a healthy opportunity for those guys to get snaps.
Right. Well, before we go to our first break, and then we'll talk more offense on the other side, because there was actually some good things that came out of the offense, even though they only scored 10 points in this game. I figure this is probably going to be at least a little bit of a narrative, because anytime you get blown out like this, you know, conversation inevitably goes to coaching. Did you have any issue with the Lions being uber aggressive on fourth down, even in their own zone in this game?
I didn't. It felt more par for the course. I mean, hey, that fourth and one that the Lions converted after running the ball on third and five.
Right.
it felt good. It was a nice little play design. Khalif Raymond nearly dropped that pass because he caught it on his shoulder.
Scary. Yep.
Yeah. Yep. but, you know, I didn't have a problem with them being aggressive. They're on the road. You know, so many players either miss an entire week of practice or are not playing in the game. You got to try to win the football game. And I don't know. Did you have any problems with it?
No. I mean, if anyone listened to this podcast regularly, they know I am team go for it almost all the time, especially on fourth and ones. And so
there's a lot of fourth and short.
There was a fourth and one. There was a fourth and two fourths and fours. I think there's another fourth down in there as well. Maybe
those are all very very conversion worthy, right?
Yeah, and they went 3 for 5 on the fourth down. They only had one. I guess the one that anyone could really maybe have an issue with was early in the third quarter. You know, right out they fumble on the first possession. The Broncos score. It's a 24-10 game. They go for it on 4th and 2 from their own 33. Mm-hmm. The game isn't quite out of hand at that point. So that I would agree that that's on the aggressive side of things, going for it 4th and 2 on their own 33. And obviously that's one of the two that they don't pick up. And then that immediately turns into a touchdown and suddenly we're in a 21-point game instead of a 14-point game. So I can see why some people might have issues with that one. But again, you know, your defense is not playing well in this game. You know, you're going to have to put up points. You know, you're going to have to be desperate. And honestly, like, the offense is probably your strength on the team right now. So you take a shot there and try to, you know, turn this into a one score game instead of, you know, giving the ball back down 2 scores. So I don't have a huge problem with it. I think that one is going to be sticking some people's craw, but I guess the other thing too, is that they threw on all but one of the fourth downs. And I know I already saw some people complaining about that, which again, sure, I guess if you want to be nitpicky, but to me, like, play calling always seems to be a hindsight thing. Like, if it doesn't work, you're an idiot. If it does work, wow, you're smart. So,
well, hey, before you talk about, you know, the exact set of downs where you're talking about, you know, after the Lions fumble, the Broncos score a touchdown, go up 24-10, and the Lions go for it on their own 33-yard line. On 3rd and 22, what did the Lions do?
They threw the ball downfield, Ryan.
Deep pass, 20-yard completion to Josh Reynolds.
That's right.
And set him up with a 4th and 2. Go for it.
You know, but
go for it.
In retrospect, they should have run a draw play on that 3rd and 22 and just punted.
Shut up.
All right, with that, we're going to take a break. When we come back, let's talk a little bit more about the offense, because as I mentioned, there were some good things that happened. And then we're going to look to the future, because week 14 did not do the Lions any favors when it comes to draft position. But we'll talk about that and more when we come back on the PODcast. Hi, chat. How are we doing? Are we okay? Not a lot of talking today, I understand. We're a little disappointed. As far as I understand, there's also a game in overtime right now, which I'm assuming is what Ryan is checking on his phone all the time.
Bengals 49ers are in OT?
I believe they are.
Look at that. And, oh, the Bills came back.
The Bills are close as well. Man, just waiting for the draft. Fair enough. Ben Johnson? What do you want to know about Ben Johnson? Do we want to talk about Ben Johnson? Anyone figure out why Jamar Jefferson didn't touch the ball? Great question.
That is a great question.
And I believe we did get a somewhat answer from Campbell's press conference. Schlitt tweeted out, Campbell said Jamar Jefferson has been dealing with an ankle injury, also had the flu, and that kept him out of the rotation during the week, which gave the opportunity to Craig Reynolds to prove he was ready.
Netflix. Who had a pretty good game, man.
He had a, I mean, he didn't fumble the ball. Why? What's happening? Why are you DMing me stuff? I don't want to see this.
Yes, you do.
No, I don't. Ryan.
Go Pack, go.
Did you hit on the other 4?
I did.
Can I show the people this? Or do you not want it?
That's fine.
How do you get a $450 free bet? Here you go. Ryan's 5-leg parlay. Which I don't... Why does it hit that hard on... I guess just because it's a parlay, but like, you didn't take any big upsets here.
You don't get the 450 back from the initial bet.
Right. I figured that one out the hard way when I gambled once. And I'm like, I'm going to beat the system and just pick the biggest favorite ever and just put the money in my pocket. And then I won 10 cents on a bet.
Hell yeah, brother. Yeah.
There you go.
That's
why he's saying go Pack go, because
hold on. What was the best 1 o'clock game that you watched?
There wasn't one.
They all sucked.
They were all horrible. Suck? They were. I was watching Red Zone, and they're like, they just kept showing the Chiefs score against the Raiders, and I'm just like, this isn't fun.
You know, I think I agree with you for the most part, but then there were some games that, like, were not close, and then they ended up being close. Like, Dak Prescott threw an interception to make the Washington game a one-score game.
Well, that must have gotten close after the Lions game started, though.
It was like right around kickoff. Yeah, it was right around kickoff time because that game was taking a little long. And then the Browns and the Ravens, like the Ravens with Tyler Huntley came all the way back.
I missed that too.
Yeah. So
did they? I see they lost by two. Did they not get a 2-point conversion? Oh no. They just
nope. They had a chance to get into.
Oh, they recovered an onside kick.
Yes.
Oh boy.
Yeah.
Man, yeah, and you have Justin Tucker, and you recover an onside kick at the 41-yard line. You need 20 yards. That's it to win the ball game.
God, it feels like he got cucked.
Yikes. By the way, Buffalo is currently 15 yards away from the game-winning score against the Bucks right now.
Do you know who the rushing leader is for the Buffalo Bills right now?
I looked, but that's not that surprising, right? Josh Allen can run the ball.
12 carries for 109 yards?
Yeah, dude.
That I guarantee that's his largest total of his career.
I don't know if I would guarantee that, but I probably. I mean, that seems like a not.
No, that seems like a really bad guarantee, but it seems like it's definitely in the top three of his, like.
Dang it. I picked the wrong Josh Allen from Pro Football Reference. Career game log.
Rushing. Well, he didn't do it this year.
He had 135 yards in 2018 against the.
His rookie season.
On 9 carries. There you go. You're wrong.
Game's not over yet. He's going to run it in from the 15-yard line.
My parlay needs the Buffalo kicker to shank this. Ooh. You didn't have Buffalo on your parlay, right?
Or the
Bucks. It is
it's
top.
It's fourth and two from the Tampa Bay 7.
It is?
Oh, they kicked the field goal.
Cowards! They had first and 10 at the 15. What happened?
I'm going to look at the play-by-play here.
Then they ran for 8 yards. Wait, no, incomplete.
Incomplete short to Stephon Diggs on third and two.
Cowards.
That is cowardly. Oh,
the Bengals kicked a field goal in overtime. I'm assuming that was the first possession. It was.
Oh, my gosh. There's only 6:15 left in the in overtime.
Well, it's a 10-minute quarter.
Why do they do that? Why not just make it the normal 15?
Because the entire point of overtime is to get the game to end as quickly as possible. That's what they want. That's why baseball did the whole rule change with starting the 10th inning with a guy on second or whatever.
Yeah, I think they're getting rid of that rule, though, aren't they?
Are they?
I think they are.
Cowards! I liked it! What's wrong? Like, oh, God, this is just baseball purists being, that's not how the game is supposed to be played. It hurts my pitcher's ERA.
Do you know what they should really do if they want football games to get over with as soon as possible? The first team scores the wins.
I mean, good, but people get pissed off about that too.
Well, then just start watching hockey because they have it figured out. Hockey has it all figured out.
They kind of do with their overtimes, both in regular season and in overtime in playoffs.
Yeah,
and it's interesting because there was originally a pretty big pushback for shootouts, but I think we've all been like, you know what? They kind of kick ass. It's fine. And plus we get 3-on-3 now beforehand, which is even more awesome.
3-on-3 is awesome. It's super fun. They should include a rule where you're not allowed to skate the puck back across your own blue line.
Yeah, it's a very soccer-like move.
Yeah, it's stupid. I don't like that part. It makes it more like soccer, and soccer sucks. But I think they have it pretty much figured out. In terms of making things more like college football over time, would you be a fan of that in the NFL?
Yeah, but even they, I feel like even they made an unpopular change to college overtime recently, right? Like that with, what is it? You get to third overtime and it's just 2-point conversions from there.
You have to go for two. Yeah,
no, you don't even just go, like, it's only 2-point conversions.
Oh,
there's no drives anymore. You just like, it's just 2-point play for this team. Yeah. 2-point play. That's why that, what was it? Yeah. Iowa, Penn State or something went to like,
no, Illinois, Penn State.
Illinois,
yeah.
Penn State went to like 10 overtime,
eight overtimes,
whatever it was. But yeah, I mean, I've always kind of been in favor of college overtime. I know some people get irked by the fact that you get to start on the 30, 35 or 25 or whatever it is. But I'm down.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm just more in favor of seeing like more high stakes offense.
Okay.
You know what I mean? So sure. like just put the offensive team like in scoring range. Like right from the start, like that makes it makes it fun. It makes it more snappy. Yeah. If you can't score, then get off the field. You suck.
Plus, it mostly takes out special teams, which you know I'm in favor of.
Oh, hell yeah. Hell yeah. Like who wants to see a punt in overtime? That sounds fucking boring.
While we're at it, just get rid of punts completely. You do ice Cecil? I don't believe you. You don't want to see a punt.
Nobody wants to see punts in overtime.
Oh, there's a Zazu request. Zazu, come here. I got peanuts, which I've discovered that you like.
Oh, 49ers are on the Cincinnati 23. Oh.
All right, sit. Sit. Just relax. Relax. Leave it. Good boy. Chew it at least, you sicko.
Damn, that's a thick boy.
Leave it. Thank you. All right, here you go. All
right, good. Jeremy, the 49ers are 3rd and 5 from the Cincinnati 21.
Should we do play-by-play?
Well, no, we shouldn't. No. But what I'm saying is if it's like 4th and 2, do you go for it or do you kick the field goal and play for the tie?
How much time is left?
3:22.
It's 3rd and what?
3rd and 5 from the Cincinnati 21.
If you can get it down to a 4th and 2 or shorter, I would go for it.
Hey, timeout number 1 by San Francisco. Kyle Shanahan's got to think about this 3rd and 5 play.
Probably should. You know what? While we're talking about overtime rules, no timeouts. Let's get this game going.
Oh,
0 timeouts.
I like that idea too.
Running clock.
A running clock, no timeouts. Right, you're not allowed to punt.
Honestly, like if you keep everything else the same and just say no punting, I'm 100% in. Because that suddenly makes the coin toss a little bit trickier, right?
It does, because, hey, do you want the ball first? You really trust your offense to not mess up on 4th down?
Yeah.
Yeah. No, I love it.
We figured it out. It. We figured it out, everybody.
Oh.
We figured out how to fix overtime. I kind of want to stall here until at least one of these overtime games ends.
Me too, because I'm paying way too close of attention to it.
Corey Aaron said, Kittle. Did he do something? Oh, he did get the 1st down. Spoiler.
Oh, he did. He has...
He's going off, isn't he?
They did not update this yet, but before that catch, he had 12... Or he has 13 catches for 151 yards and a touchdown.
Well, at least one Iowa tight end did something good today.
Oh.
Did Noah Fant ever come back after that injury? He finished with 4 and 51, so maybe.
But he did have that one catch where Derek Barnes in coverage.
Yeah, it's a tough matchup for him, but also.
Come on.
I would have liked to see him at least a little closer. I mean, he's a speedy guy, right?
That's what I thought Derek Barnes could do. That's what I thought.
Has Kyle come back in 2 weeks? No, he's been mysteriously gone for the past 2 weeks. I wonder what's happened.
Who's that?
Kyle Barber.
Oh.
He DM'd me on Discord this morning with the Wikipedia page of Justin Tucker. That's it. Just a link to Justin Tucker on Wikipedia. Very rude. Very rude.
Sounds like he got what he deserved.
And I may have, after Lamar Jackson got injured, said, "Oh wow, the karma's nice today." And yeah, probably not one of my best moments, considering it was involved a quarterback getting injured. But I felt he deserved a low blow. He deserved a low blow.
Can we talk about all the? No, we don't need to talk about it, but. If you're on Twitter running victory laps about Lamar Jackson getting injured, like, oh, this is what happens to running quarterbacks. Right. It's like, well, it took long enough.
Right.
Like, stop.
He misses one. Like, I mean, he's been in every big game for them, right? Like, ugh.
Yeah.
Josh Woods took over the green dot after Anzalone went out, which is interesting because this week Aaron Glenn said they were going to have some packages where it was going to be Barnes and Josh Woods, and Barnes would have the green dot. They do not trust Derek Barnes yet.
He is a rookie.
He is a rookie, and at least he's getting some playing time, but
yeah,
it's kind of sad.
This game might be over, but it's first and goal from the Cincinnati one. It says play under review.
Oh.
Maybe Brandon Ayuk might have gotten the end zone. But Jeremy, if it say this theoretical situation plays out, if it's...
Yes, you go for it.
Doesn't matter. Fourth and one?
From the 1 yard line? 1,000% go for it.
All right.
Not even close. Like, the 49ers are in dire situation when it comes to the playoff race anyways. Like,
they need a win. They need a tie doesn't help.
Yeah. It's not even close. Lord Goofa says, Ayuk catch overturned. Does that mean he didn't catch it or he didn't score a touchdown on it? Because I'm not seeing. I don't have the game in front of me.
It said that he got pushed out at the one on the ESPN Gamecast.
Lionswell says that's a TD. I'm going to go pull up my phone so maybe I can watch it. No. Oh, it's right here. Is this even going to be available for me to watch on the Yahoo app? Probably not. Says NFL Live, Chiefs and Raiders on right now. I think that might be a little outdated. Oh no, I got Bills Bucks. Sad. Trey Lance QB sneak it at least four times. I don't hate it. I don't hate it. Has he done anything? Like, do they have any packages for him anymore, or is that just done?
It feels like that's just over.
That's weird.
I don't know why it says the San Francisco win percentage on ESPN is 83.6%. It feels like it should be higher.
It does feel like it should be higher.
Can you believe that we need to talk about this Lions game for like 40 more minutes?
It's so tough to pull anything from
this touchdown!
Ah! 49ers win.
49ers win.
Much to the Vikings chagrin, I guess. Vikings probably don't like that too much. Washington probably doesn't like that too much, especially since they lost, right?
Yeah, the Bengals, man. That sucks. They really had an opportunity to make ground up in the AFC North.
Here's the thing, though. Like, if Lamar is out for an extended period of time, look at Baltimore's schedule. You want me to read it to you?
Yeah.
Baltimore scheduled final four games of the season. Packers, Bengals,
Ow.
Rams,
Ow.
Steelers.
Is the Bengals game, is it on the road or at home?
At Cincy. Packers, the other three are at home, but it's pretty rough. They could certainly lose the grasp on that. You know what? I'm going to say this. I don't think that division's very good.
It's not good. I'm with you. I don't think the Ravens are particularly good. But at the same time, they've been absolutely ravaged by injuries.
They have. And it also seems very weird to call a division that literally is 500 and above for all four teams not very good. But the Steelers are frauds. The Browns, I don't know, are frauds. They're not going to get very far. They can hang like one good game every 3 weeks.
Mm-hmm.
Bengals, I think the Bengals are the best team in the division, but I don't know what happened today. I didn't watch any of that game.
Yeah, I mean, Burrow was 25 of 34 for 348 and two touchdowns, even though he had a pinky injury. So, I mean.
So what happened? They couldn't run the ball, it looks like, which.
It just looks like.
Hurts a little bit since they ran the ball so well against us.
Yeah, I mean, it was just the.
Defense wasn't playing very well either.
If anything, I mean, it looks like it was just turnovers. Bengals lost two fumbles.
Icy, so let me explain to you the Netflix thing very quickly. So if you remember Craig Reynolds, I know I'm going to say Josh too many times when I mean Craig.
No,
just like it was the
you got it. Craig.
Craig Reynolds. The Lions ended up adding him right before their first preseason game because I think they had a ravish of injuries right before their first preseason game. They signed him on a Wednesday. He plays for them on Thursday, and he puts up like 62 yards and a touchdown in the first preseason game. Everyone goes crazy about him. We talked to Deuce Staley about him, and he's like, yeah, man, he came in and jumped up off his couch. That's why we call him Netflix. He was at home watching Netflix on his couch. And then jumped up into their starting lineup and took advantage of his opportunity. So they call him Netflix because he was unemployed for one day and then jumped right in.
You know, because his name is Craig, I feel like his nickname should be Friday. Just because of the quote from Smokey where he says, "You ain't got no job, you ain't got shit to do."
It's pretty good. It was pretty good.
Thank you.
That's right. Yeah, he was meeting guys in the huddle. That is also true.
Really, he was meeting guys in the huddle.
That was maybe the best part of that story. But also, I don't know what's gonna come of him, and we'll probably talk about this next in the next segment too. But like, guys who make the most of their opportunities like that, like this feels a little bit different than like, let's say I don't know Zach Zetter hype, right? Like it feels a little different than that.
11 carries for 83 yards. I mean, I know one of them was a big pop off, but
yeah. Anyways, we'll get to that.
It feels different, Jeremy, because the Lions already have like established running backs ahead of him. You know what I mean? Like, yeah. I think it feels like Craig Reynolds could be like a nice like
RB3. Yeah.
Yeah.
But the Lions already have a good RB1, a good RB2. Some would say. I mean, Godwin's going to be a topic today. Jamar, we'll see. It's a shame we didn't get to see more Jamar today. But basically, Craig Reynolds took a spot and did pretty damn well. So it's not like Jamar would have really done much differently, I would imagine.
Yeah. Real quick, before we get in the second segment, can we just have a moment of silence for all the former Lions that are on the Jacksonville Jaguars?
I feel like we have to talk. We're definitely going to talk about that in the third segment when we're talking about draft pick, right?
All
right,
cool.
Because
yeah, we should.
Jacksonville's not going to win another game. I mean, they might win next week against Houston, but that's what we got to talk about. I don't know if Chris is going to have time to do a what do we call them?
It's been scraps.
Scraps. First of all, I think us fixing overtime should be the first topic in scraps.
Yep.
The second topic. In scraps, and it's a little bit deflated because it turns out they weren't stunting.
I know.
But I want to talk about Dallas and their benches, and I also want to talk about Oakland and their pregame huddle on the logo. And
they did what?
They during the pregame, like they were like the Chiefs were warming up, I think, all the way in their own end zone, and so the Raiders decide to move their warm up on the Chiefs logo. And I want, like, we'll talk about it, but I this whole, like, obsession over disrespecting our logo is a weird, stupid thing, but I want to get into that our second break. We'll save that for the second break.
This is such a Michigan thing.
What does that mean?
Just comes back to that Michigan-Michigan State game, where wasn't it Devin Bush who just, like, was ripping up the Spartans logo?
I honestly don't even remember that. I just think all of like the
logo. Yeah, because you weren't a Michigan fan at that point.
How dare you?
I have $50 on Michigan winning the national championship.
Oh, the other game is over.
No, what happened?
Brady 2, you won't believe this. No, Rashad Perriman with the game winner! No freaking way!
A 58-yard touchdown from Rashad Perriman.
Oh, I'm sick.
I don't want to.
I don't want to be here anymore. Can I get? Can I get? I don't want to be here anymore. Emotes in the chat, please.
There he is on third.
Hold on. I don't want the sound on, but I'll let you guys watch it. What? Where is everybody? Where is everybody? What? Like, okay, so, you know, kudos to Brashad. He got a yard and a half worth of separation. The Bills are only sending five. Like, you've got six guys in coverage covering four people. Why is there absolutely no one within 40 yards of Brashad Perriman? Where is a safety on the play? You've got four guys here, which means there's two people back here somewhere. What? What is happening? It's not cover zero. I don't think it's cover zero. I mean, they're only rushing five. Jesus. Okay. Now, before everyone goes crazy, no one can blame the Lions for what they did with Rashad Perriman. Absolutely nobody, right?
God, no. Stop.
Like, no one can actually be mad. Maybe they did only have 10 on the field. I don't know. But, I mean, come on.
The Bills only had 10 players on the field?
That's what someone's guessing.
That would not be good.
Rashad Perriman. You know what? Good for him. I'm sure he's had a very frustrating year. Man, who's good in the AFC outside of the frickin' New England Patriots? I guess the Titans and the Chiefs are coming on, finally.
Chargers, question mark?
Chargers are just so inconsistent, man.
I know. Seems like one week they're dominant, and then another week they're flailing.
Yeah.
They absolutely mollywopped the Giants today. I know it was 37-21, but that game was like well over by halftime.
Dolphins.
Mike Glennon played football today.
What team is he on?
The Giants.
Oh God! Did they bench? What's his name? Danny Dimes.
Daniel Jones. Danny Dimes is out with an injury.
Oh. Someone named Riley Dixon threw a pass in that game too. Who is he?
I don't know who that is.
Is he a punter? I think he might be a punter. He is their punter. Yes. He did not complete it.
Jack Fox for the win, baby.
All right, we should stop dilly-dallying. Get into some offensive talk.
We keep talking about just random shit, but yeah, I would love to talk about offense, right?
Yes, sir.
All right.
All right, give me a second. And we are back here on the PODcast, recapping the Lions' 38-10 loss to the Denver Broncos. We talked a little bit about the defense and the first segment. Let's move over to the offense, where, as I'm teased, some good things happened. And let's start there because, hey, the Lions can still run the ball. They don't need Jamal Williams. They don't need DeAndre Swift. They ran for 118 yards and 5-6 a carry in this game. Surprised by that, Ryan?
A little bit. I mean, when you consider that, you know, the Lions were on a third string center.
True. He wasn't very good, but he was in the game, and they ran the ball kind of behind him sometimes.
Yeah. Is this how we're really going to start the segment? Like, kind of good, maybe? Question mark?
They lost by 28 points, Ryan. What do you want from me? To pretend like everything's great?
Taylor Deckard had a reception for negative 2 yards.
That, I mean, that's a whole different thing. There was, what, like 5 batted balls in this game?
Okay. That was what maybe was most frustrating about this game in terms of Jared Goff. Like today, yeah. Jared Goff was really frustrating because why were so many balls getting batted down at the line of scrimmage? And it was a perfect way to end the game for the Denver Broncos because they batted that ball down to end the football game. But let's just talk more about Jared Goff. Okay. We'll get back to the running game in a second, but like there was, It felt like a typical Jared Goff game because there was some good Jared Goff.
Yep.
And then there was some very bad Jared Goff. And, you know, even when the game was out of hand, when he tried to push the ball down the field, like he was just like overshooting receivers, yeah, like left and right. And it was just like overshoot. It's like, all right, you know what? I'm getting the ball down the field. And, you know, I think that was what was most frustrating about his performance is those two things, like batted balls at the line of scrimmage when like that hasn't really been a problem all season long. And, you know, if the Lions want to push the ball down the field, at least give the receiver a shot.
Yeah.
I mean, let your receiver make a play.
Or underthrow it because you'll get pass interference like 90% of the time. Like overthrows are always the worst because you're just not giving anyone a chance to make a play.
Yeah.
But yeah, like I had a thought like halfway through the third quarter when the Lions, I think, were down either 2 or 3 scores. I'm like, you know what? Jared Goff's not playing terribly in this game. I would say he's like the 10th biggest problem. But then the problem is like the rest of the game happened. And it goes back to what I said before. Like Jared Goff just isn't the guy that's going to take you out of a 21 point hole because
nope.
He wasn't very good at those downfield throws. He's, you usually have to like absolutely twist his arm to even get him to throw those kind of plays. And I guess he just does it so infrequently now that he's not as accurate as he used to be, because accuracy actually used to not be a big problem for him. He used to be a great downfield passer, and then he either lost confidence in doing it, he lost his vision in doing it, and now he wasn't very accurate in this game when it came to it.
You wouldn't say that he was under any like special duress this game too, right? Like, I mean, really. I felt like the offensive line did a fairly commendable job.
Yeah.
All things considered, of yeah, keeping him pretty clean in the pocket, Goff, and giving him time to throw.
It looks like Goff took 2 sacks, hits.
Right?
Yeah, 2 sacks and 4 quarterback hits, which is not that bad. And one of them was the direct result of, you know, bad center play, which again can probably be like, let's not beat up on Ryan McCollum in his first career start. Like,
yeah,
that's tough to do for anybody. But and Goff always has this problem. Like he had it on the fourth down, I think it was that ended the 16 play drive. He just faded away from the pocket right into Taylor Decker's guy, and you know, forces him to throw off his back foot and all this sort of stuff. And it's just, he's never had good pocket presence since he's landed in here. He has poor vision, and I don't know, like his accuracy wasn't on today either. And so put all those together, you're never going to come back from 21 points with a quarterback playing like that. And I don't want to put it, like I said, I don't want to really put it all on Goff, because I thought he played well in the first half, honestly. Like, mm-hmm, not outstanding, but I thought he played well enough. And you can't hammer the guy for, you know, -5 yards in the first quarter when, what, he threw the ball once, maybe? Like, they had 6-3 plays, I think, in the entire first quarter because the defense couldn't get off the field, so...
Yeah, I mean, the Broncos were just running the ball ad nauseum. I mean, they had over, like, 12 minutes of possession time.
Yeah. So, you know, when Goff had his early chances, he was doing fine. And you can say play design, whatever, for the touchdown pass, but he still made the pass. So, I don't know. It seemed like he was playing a pretty good game until he wasn't, which, again, like, that's Jared Goff so far. Like, he'll give you a quarter, maybe sometimes a half. But we haven't seen 4 quarters out of Jared Goff, and we certainly didn't see him there today. And again, it's just who he is. Like, and that's why, like, I think I'm done. Like, most people were done already. Some people may have gotten back on the Jared Goff after, you know, offensive player of the week. Jared Goff played pretty well last week, at least in one quarter. But now I'm back to, like, this guy just can't dig you out of a hole. And this is the NFL. Sometimes you're going to be down two scores. Even the best teams are going to find themselves down two scores sometimes. If you're getting a quarterback who can only play when the game's within 7 points, like, you don't have a quarterback. That's just not how you can survive in today's NFL, and that's just not what Jared Goff is capable of doing. So, you know, back to normal, I think, with him. I don't think this was building upon last week, although, you know, it certainly wasn't as bad as, you know, the stretch right out of the bye, right? Like, where they're only throwing it within 5 yards of the line of scrimmage. I guess that's where the progress is. Like, we've been talking all week about the influence that Ben Johnson has had on the offense and them being more aggressive. Well, I think for the past two or really 3 weeks, if you look at those passing charts that we like to obsess over after every game, those are getting better in terms of just trying to push the ball downfield. Does that count as progress?
I think that counts as progress, like his average depth of target. Yeah. I think what also counts as progress is Amon-Ra St. Brown.
Sure.
12 targets, eight catches for 73 yards, and he probably got highlighted on the Telestrator.
I counted six times. Yeah. Is that what you mean by eight targets? Was it eight targets from the Telestrator? We just felt the need. By the way, this is a great opportunity to go to Amon-Ra St. Brown. He's right here in the slot.
You know, I think that was just Mark Sanchez being like, I don't know a lot of these Lions players, but Amon-Ra, he caught a touchdown at the end of the last game, and he's playing in this game, and he's got to be a favorite target of Jared Goff. Jared Goff did get the ball around. I mean, like, Zylstra had a couple catches. Brock Wright had a few catches. Cleef Raymond, Josh Reynolds, Craig Reynolds. Tom Kennedy even had a reception. Like, I mean, I just listed off all of those players, Jeremy. I mean, that's the island of misfit toys.
but at the same time, like, I think Amon-Ra and Josh Reynolds are playing well right now. Like,
they're NFL players.
Good. Yeah. And so, yes, like, if that's your one and two next year, like, it's not the end of the world. I mean, you need depth in case either of those guys get injured, and you'd love to have, like, a prime time number one for sure. But it's not as dire as I felt a month ago, right?
Well, I mean, Breshad Perriman just caught a 53-yard touchdown pass to end the game.
Stop it.
You go into next season and Amon-Ra St. Brown and Josh Reynolds are on your roster. That's a better starting point than the Lions were at the beginning of the season.
Yeah.
Like, I think a lot of people talk themselves into Breshad Perriman. It's like, oh, reclamation project. Right. Ooh. And, you know, even with Tyrell Williams, it was like, well, he's flashed, you know, at times. I think at least what you're getting out of those two guys is, you know, you're getting some production, and you're getting some, you know, Amon-Ra is a guy who the reason why I like him so much as a receiver is, like, he'll catch the ball and then it's like he's getting upfield.
Yeah.
Like,
you will not knock that man backwards.
No, that guy's putting his shoulder into you, and he's getting some extra yards. So that's why I really like him. I like Cleef Raymond too. Like, you know, he ends up catching that touchdown pass on that fun play design. But, you know, Cleef Raymond is a guy who's like, tell me why he shouldn't be your wide receiver four.
Right.
Tell me why he shouldn't be your wide receiver four / punt return / maybe kick return guy.
What I like too is that the Lions are doing a good job, like, using these guys creatively, because, I mean, we mentioned the touchdown play, but how about Amon-Ra coming out of the backfield as a running back? We've seen that a few times this year, and I don't know who exactly is designing some of these plays, but they're playing to these guys' strength, which is, I guess, I don't know how this turned into a positive about the passing game when we just, like, buried Jared Goff for 5 minutes, but this is some of the stuff that we saw, I think, earlier in the season, where there's some creativeness to what they're doing there, that they're using Amon-Ra's, you know, versatility on the inside and outside. They're using Cleef Raymond's speed to beat, you know, cornerback sideline to sideline. And it feels good to see some creative plays again, because it just felt like the creative juices were gone by, like, week six.
let's all agree on something. We really don't want Dan Campbell calling plays.
Probably not.
I don't think we want Dan Campbell calling plays, because look at what you just said. Like at the beginning of, you know, the season, even in the preseason, there was like some fun stuff that like Anthony Lynn was doing, especially when like you consider a lot of NFL offenses to be so very vanilla because they're not going to show their hand at what they're doing. But, you know, the first couple of weeks, like, oh, there's some fun stuff happening on the offense. And then, you know, for that few game stretch, it was a lot of like smash mouth, run the football, right. Even if it's on third and, you know, all the way to the other side of the country, they're still going to be running the football. I think what we can all agree on is that the Lions need somebody to be creative on offense. And I think what we're seeing is that creativeness can pay dividends even when you have very little talent.
But the trajectory of this offense, the way it feels like what happened this year, like the story of 2021 will be this. They came out with a lot of interesting looks, a lot of different things, and I think they felt that they overwhelmed the team. They even said publicly, like, we need to scale some of this stuff back.
Yeah, like they put too much on their plate.
There was too much verbiage. There was too many plays. They just wanted to nail things down to the things they did well. And by the time you got to week six, what was the only thing that was really working? The run game. And so we saw that first for 4 or 5 weeks. And now out of the bye week, out of the reigning games and the Jared Goff injury, I feel like they're starting to build it back up. I feel like they're starting to add some of those pieces again. Maybe that's what it is. Maybe they needed Jared Goff to get comfortable. They need the wide receivers to get comfortable and start running the right routes. And now they're starting to build it up. And I think I even see our live chat. Like, they're all saying, Ben Johnson. It's all Ben Johnson. Like, he's the reason. It's hard to say, but all we know is that the Lions very much like Ben Johnson. And he talked to the media for the first time last week and sounded like a very impressive human being. Didn't know a ton about him in terms of his history before this week, and so maybe it does seem like Ben Johnson is going to be some part of this offense going forward, whether it's pass game coordinator, whether he gets a shot at offensive coordinator if/when Anthony Lynn gets ousted. But it's something to consider. I guess I hadn't considered this while watching the game because it didn't seem like a particularly fun game to watch, but it does feel like they're making some strides there in the passing game in terms of just mixing things up and using their guys the way that they should.
Yeah, I can agree with all that. Can you agree with me that Godwin Igwebuke should probably like not carry the football all that often?
It's been a rough year for him, like, because he lost kickoff duties early in the year because of fumbles, if you remember that.
And yep, then like I do.
It's tricky though too, because he has been good running the ball, and he wasn't particularly bad running the ball today, but critical fumble to start the second half, and then almost did it again. After that 18
in the red zone
or whatever,
yeah,
finishes the game eight for 25, so not very efficient, but it's not like, I don't feel like he left a lot of yards out there. But Craig Reynolds certainly didn't leave a lot of yards out there either.
No, is that what we're gonna do? Is it just all positive spin on the football team that scored 10 points?
Do you want me to hammer on Godwin Igwebuke? Like, I don't know. Like, here.
No, I don't want you to crush the guy. I'm just saying that you know what? It was probably out of necessity, right?
They didn't want to play Jamar because, as we discovered during the break, like, he was dealing both with an ankle injury and the flu, so he was basically only dressed for emergency today. Like, that was the game plan going in.
Yeah. So if it wasn't for that, I think you would have saw a lot of Jamar Jefferson and a lot of Craig Reynolds.
I agree. It would have been surprising, but yeah, I think you might be right.
It would have been surprising, but it just ended up, you know, even being the case, I think like Craig got a lot of play, you know, from the jump. I know him and Godwin were kind of going back and forth, but it seemed, I was pretty surprised. Like, I know, like, I didn't have the foresight, you know, to know that, that Jamar was being held out because of the ankle injury, but like seeing so much Craig Reynolds, it was like, wow, that's kind of surprising.
Yeah.
Even with Jamar Jefferson not really getting any play, because you would consider, well, I don't know, Godwin's been on the active roster and he's been getting carries, so why isn't he getting more play?
Can I talk about how I was like, two and a half quarters into that game, I was riding around with a feather in my cap being like, you know what? This is a great day for team running backs don't matter. Lions are down their first two, top two running backs. Godwin Ogbuike and Craig Reynolds are just running it all over. And then, like, I even put a very snarky tweet out there. It's like, it's interesting that the Lions running game is doing so well without their top two running backs. It's almost like, and then I stopped the tweet right there. And then, like, a quarter later, the fumbles start happening. And it's just like, oh, yeah, that's right. They don't lose. They hadn't lost a lot of fumbles. A guy like Jamal Williams has literally fumbled once in his entire career, and that happened last week. But I still kind of feel the same way. Like, the fact that Craig Reynolds can come out of nowhere, a guy who's been on the practice squad, you know, basically working with scout teams all season, come in and almost have a 100-yard game, despite the fact that this team was losing behind the entire game, still puts up 83 yards on 11 carries. It does kind of prove my point, right? Let's kind of prove it a little bit. Maybe not prove it, but it supports my point.
You just want me to say yes.
I do. I want you to be on the right side of history.
Well, hold on. Let's do the thing that you love to do.
You want to take away his big run?
You get rid of Craig Reynolds' big run of 35 yards. He's still averaging 4.8 yards a carry.
There you go. Nailed it.
Oh, man. I don't want to talk about this offense anymore.
All I want... Lions, look me in the eyes here. I know Swift hasn't been reliably healthy. I know you only have Jamal Williams for one more year.
Please don't sign DeAndre Swift to a contract extension.
Don't do that. And don't draft a running back on day one or day two. That's all I ask. Please. That's all I ask. Load up on defense. Get yourself a quarterback. Get yourself a wide receiver. Let's have ourselves a 2022.
Use the Rams pick to take Kenneth Walker and watch Jeremy.
No.
Jeremy burn.
No. Absolutely not. All right, we're going to take our second break. When we come back, we're going to talk about draft order. Great lead in. We're talking about taking Kenneth Walker at all. And we'll talk about where the Lions might be picking, both with their pick and the Rams pick, with a big Monday night game coming to impact that. But we'll talk about all that when we come back on the BOD cast.
Go Cods, go.
Is that your Bronx accent thing that you and Chris do? Are you sure?
No, that was Arnold Schwarzenegger.
What?
Go Chargers, go.
What? I don't think so. You're wrong. Can we mute Ryan for 30 seconds?
Go Cards, go.
Jesus. I don't know what that is, but I hate it. I need chat to be bigger on the screen. How do I do that? I need to make you guys bigger. I clicked on the wrong thing.
You know Tom Brady is the he's the favorite to be the MVP this year.
What?
Yeah.
God, it's just people are so boring with their MVP votes. Best quarterback on the best team. Get ballsy. Impromptu list cast, says Aura Flux. What do you got for us, Aura? Things you guys would do to have the Lions be Super Bowl contenders. So he wants us to do a Klondike bar-esque list.
What would you do for a Lions Super Bowl appearance or victory?
Not even for the Lions to be Super Bowl contenders.
Contenders?
Contenders.
I guess it all doesn't really matter that much.
What am I reading? I'm reading Chet Fredbear. Watch Bill Burr's Arnold bit. I don't know if I want to do that. I don't want to think of anything Arnold Schwarzenegger after that impression.
Shut up. Things I would do in order for the Lions to be Super Bowl contenders.
Would you shave your head?
No. No, I say no just because I feel like I'm too close to, like, not losing my hair, but, like, I feel like if I make it all go away, like, it's not going to come back the same way.
I'm a little afraid of that, too. I'm not losing my hair currently, but I'm still very afraid of that. For some reason, I'm thinking, like, it'll change the chemistry in my head if I shave my head, and it just won't come back.
You're just one head shave away from becoming George Costanza.
Right. Or I have also the fear that it's all going to be gray. Cause like, if you can see, I'm getting kind of, I'm getting significantly gray on the sides.
You're very salt and peppery.
Yeah.
Which I think is really in with the women, by the way. I think it's in.
On the sides. I don't know.
Yeah. No. I think the sides is where you want it to be.
Is it?
You don't want it to be up top.
I guess. Maybe. I don't know how it works. I keep pulling gray hairs out of my mustache. I don't like that. I'm 35. Gray hairs, I think, are semi-normal for a 35-year-old, right?
No, yeah, for sure. Totally. Here's something I would give up. I would give up Thai food for a year.
Thai food?
I love Thai food.
I love Thai food too, but I also feel like I get Thai food once a month, so that's like getting rid of Thai food for 12 times. How often do you eat Thai food?
But probably like once a month too, but like that one time a month, I'm like, man, I'm like really jonesing for some Thai food.
How about finger pitas?
Jeremy, we need to be reasonable. I'd give up gambling for a year.
No, you wouldn't. I would. Here's the problem, though. If the Lions are Super Bowl contenders, that's only going to make you more eager to bet on them.
No.
Yes. Yep.
Which, by the way, if you're following the Pride of Detroit articles that I'm posting.
Yeah. I hit again. Only follow these daily or these weekly parlays he throws on Saturday. Do not follow him when he says the Lions are only -21 right now or +21 right now on Twitter. Don't follow that advice.
They were down. No, like Caesars wouldn't let you bet on it. It was something that was messed up in their system. It was 14-10 and the Lions were +22.5.
How'd that work out?
Thank God, because I was this close to putting a lot of
money on it, I bet.
Yeah.
Someone wants to know do you remember what your bet, your three-part parlay was?
Yeah, it was the Denver Broncos to win, so nailed it. The other one was Jared Goff over 169.5 passing yards.
And you not only did you nail that one, but you nailed the explanation, which was the Lions are going to be playing from behind.
Yes. And Jerry Jeudy over 34.5 receiving yards.
Was that one close? Did you need that last drive catch that he had?
That last catch, yeah, that was a big one.
Oh boy.
47 yards.
Yep.
Yep. Okay. Yep.
And that paid out what, like +200 or something?
No, it was +110. Okay. So it was better than a hand of blackjack.
Yeah.
I'm doing pretty good. I don't know. What are some things that you would give up or that you would do?
I forgot that was the topic.
I
feel like I could probably do a food one. Like, I mean, I don't, it's not fair for me to say I'd give up drinking because I have a beer a month. So that's not it.
I wish I could relate.
This is going to seem a little pathetic, but I'd give up Fortnite, which I play probably about 5 times a week. By the way, it was really fun playing Halo with you Saturday night. Friday night.
And then I woke up Saturday morning and like the power was just out because there were 70-mile-per-hour winds outside my house.
Because you've made public all of my betrayals of you, I feel like, and this one is incredibly minor by scale, but I feel like I have to out you anyways, just so
didn't
I have
you
one
still
tally.
Play with Alex? Didn't you still play with Alex?
We played one game. He doesn't like Halo, so I played one game with Alex while I waited for you, who I get you had fallen asleep.
Yeah, I fell asleep. Okay.
The best part about that story though is, what was your first message to me? Do you remember? You messaged me at about 10:20 on Friday night.
Are you still awake?
And then you fell asleep when I said, yeah, let's play Halo. You fell asleep.
What are some other things that you would do in order for the Lions to be Super Bowl contenders?
I don't do anything. That's like, I don't have vices. I'm an extremely boring person.
Oh, would you eat an entire raw onion?
Once?
In one sitting.
Oh, God. I don't think so. I don't think so. Oh, yeah. No.
To be Super Bowl contenders?
Nope, I'm sorry.
Jeremy, you're talking about.
Ryan, do it. Take one bite and tell me.
You're talking about getting a bye week in the playoffs.
Maybe.
Maybe if they're Super Bowl contenders.
Maybe, but not. I mean, that's a one seed. That's not just Super Bowl contender. That's a one seed.
Onions don't have any seeds in them.
You haven't felt the pain I have. I'd shave my head. I'd do that.
No. Yeah, it's funny. You say you don't have many vices. I don't know if I could give up something like give up coffee for a year. I would be a less productive human being without coffee.
For some reason, this discussion reminded me of the, was it the 2014 season when they started 5-0?
Yeah,
it was. I think I said if the Lions go undefeated and win the Super Bowl at that time, I said this, I would braid my hair like Tim Toon. y'all remember Tim Toon?
Third segment, please.
No, we still have topics to discuss here.
What topics?
I teased them.
I can't remember.
Cowboys and the Raiders.
Yeah, okay, let's do it. Cowboys. So before it was beknownst to us that the Washington football team's, is it FedEx Stadium? Is that where they play?
I think that's right, yeah.
Yeah. Apparently the Cowboys were informed that the benches on the visitor sidelines like weren't really working that well in terms of like their heaters.
Yeah.
So Jerry Jones is just like, well, fuck it. We'll put benches on a plane and and bring them in ourselves.
Yeah. And that dropped at like 11 in the morning where it was just like, wow, I've never seen this before. The Cowboys brought their own benches to the sidelines.
And I loved it. I loved every single part of it.
Before we knew any of that stuff, everyone was just like, oh my God, this is an insane power move. I want to hear your side of it, because before we knew that, to me, this was just like the ultimate Jerry Jonesism and why I hate everything about how flashy this goddamn team is. Like they turn their nose down at your shitty benches. We need our own with our logo on it. Like that to me is ultimate snobbery, and I hate it. And it's part of the reason why everyone outside of Dallas and outside of bandwagon-y fans absolutely hate the Cowboys. Why did you like the move before we knew that it was actually a thing that they should have done?
So I'll say that the reason why I liked it is because I had an opportunity to read the game preview for Washington and Dallas ahead of time. I read it yesterday while I was, I think it was like just before bed, but I'm scrolling through ESPN and I'm reading game previews, and I see like both McCarthy and Rivera are like, yeah, we're excited about like this final stretch because it's essentially like a round robin tournament for the NFC East.
Yeah.
Because there's all these they're all playing each other in like rapid succession. And it just felt like, because I mean, this had like playoff implications in terms of like who might win the NFC East. Like if Washington was able to win a game here against Dallas, like that, I mean, that really puts Dallas in hot water in terms of, you know, their margin for error.
Yep.
And I thought it was like, hey, the Dallas Cowboys are coming to town and they're going to have their own benches. Like, and it wasn't just like, I don't know if you should pull up a picture of the benches, Jeremy, if you can,
sure.
But like, it wasn't just like they were like blue and silver benches. Like it was very clear that it was like the Cowboys benches, like right. Logo, team name. It was like, it was very over the top.
Yeah.
And it really felt like, you know, the worst guy that, you know, has made a very good point.
I just think it ultimately, like, I accept why they did it like that. It makes sense. If you're not going to be properly warm, like, that's, it's important.
Oh yeah. And to be fair, there were a lot of people that were like, this is so contemptuous.
Yeah.
Like, this is just like the Dallas Cowboys just being dickheads.
Yeah. And I guess like, I get that's part of the fun, right? Like, if it was any yeah. other team, I probably would have been like, oh, I like them kind of like flashing on another team, like planting their flag, so to speak, on another team's turf. But it's the Cowboys, and that makes me hate it. And if that makes me a hypocrite, then I'm a hypocrite because fuck the Cowboys.
But what if another team was on their opponent's midfield logo? Like, how would you feel about that?
Well, let me show you. I can show you because that happened today, too, because very different results, but Jesse Palmer on Twitter posted videos. You can see here the Raiders just moving, for whatever reason, onto the Chiefs logo, and you can hear Chiefs fans were not happy about that. And then, of course, if you you saw the game... You know that they got beat the hell up. What'd they end up losing by? 39 points?
Oh, my gosh. It was not good. It was, 48-9.
Here, I don't know what's more lame. People, like, trying to act like you're being super disrespectful by standing on a logo or doing whatever on a logo, planting a flag, you know, dragging your feet, whatever it is. Or the people that are like, oh, my precious logo, don't step on it. No, that has our logo. Like, do you think the players really care that much about a logo? Oh, it represents our team. Who cares? It's something that, like, some dude that probably doesn't know anything about football designed 60 years ago. It's a graphic designer's piece of art. It has nothing to do with the team. Everyone that has, like, these overt, like, I guess, like, fans can get upset of it because they wear clothes that have their logo on it, and, like, they devote all this time. I know the players wear clothes with their logo on it all the time, too, but...
They get paid to do it.
They get paid to do it. Like, they're in it for the team name. They're in it for whatever. Like, the logo, like, people attribute too much meaning to a stupid logo. I don't, like, do whatever to the logo. I don't care. I'm going to beat your ass on the football field. That's exactly what happened.
Yeah, I don't have a huge problem with the whole logo thing, because a lot of the reasons that you outlined, like, I mean, I can't imagine that the players care a whole lot about the logo. I think that's more of a fan thing.
Yeah. And whatever, like, fans, you're allowed to get upset or everything. I'm not gonna hammer you too hard on that.
But I mean, just for those keeping score at home, you do care about the logos that are on benches.
No, that's not what I no. Don't no. I just care that they brought their own. That's all. I mean, like, T.O. planting the football on the star. Great moment in football.
That's really good.
Great that's moment really good. In football.
It's really good.
Anyways, I don't know. That's my silly stories of week 14 that got a lot of attention that probably didn't need to.
The Packers didn't score in the first drive. What's going on?
Uh-oh, starting to get nervous about that parlay.
I don't like this.
Anything else, chat, you want us to talk about before we get into our final segment here? And then we'll release you all to the wild to watch Sunday Night Football. Parlay in absolute shambles. I mean, Justin Fields, dude. It's already got a 19-yard pass. You're in trouble.
The Lions open as 13.5 point underdogs at home versus Arizona next week.
Oh, that game's at home. That's right.
13.5 point underdogs at home.
I mean, I'm probably taking the Cards.
I don't know.
Really bad. Like, how are they going to contain Kyler Murray with no edge rushers?
Very carefully.
Very carefully.
I don't, is there a way I'm trying to look on? So I know before the overtime games happened that, do you want to guess who the leading passer was of this week in the NFL?
I don't have the slightest clue. Ben Roethlisberger? I don't know.
No. Nope.
It was not him.
It was Davis Mills.
Davis Mills? Did the dude like went 8 for 8 for like 75 yards on the first drive of the game, and then they score what, 10 more points the rest of the game? Not even six.
Yeah, it was not good.
He had 31 yards?
Yeah.
How did they not turn that into any points in the second half?
His QBR was 26.8.
How?
I don't know. I don't understand that. 33 of 49 for 331 yards, a touchdown, a 26.8 QBR. Russell Wilson, on the other hand, 17 of 28, 260, two touchdowns, 92.8 QBR.
This, first of all, I still don't really know what QBR is. I think it puts more emphasis on like down and distance. So if you like, if you complete a 5 yard pass on 3rd and 8. It's a negative play, not a positive, not, you know, 5 yard completion. But I'm looking at this box score. You have 331 passing yards. Your running game wasn't very good. You didn't have any turnovers. And you put up 13 points? What?
I don't know. The only two guys who surpassed him were Brady and Burrow. And both those games went to overtime.
Weird.
Weird. Week 15.
Will you guys
talk about it?
Will you guys be doing a simulcast cast when Michigan plays on the 31st? Interesting. Maybe. You want to join me? Come on, Ryan.
I don't even want to be around anymore.
Spend New Year's with me. Did anyone put that emote in the chat when I asked? I didn't see it. So QBR... is it incorporates all the quarterback's contributions to winning. Okay, that's very... including how he impacts the game on passes, rushes, turnovers, and penalties. Very specific. Since QBR is built from the play level, it accounts for the team's level of success or failure on every play to provide proper context, then allocates credit to the quarterback and his teammates to produce clear measure of quarterback efficiency. That is the most vague bullshit I've ever seen. Sounds like EPA. That's what it sounds like. Expected points added. That's what it sounds like. It's expected points added put on a scale of 0 to 100. That's what it was. That's what I'm going to say it is. Are you okay? Is this because the Bears are first and goal?
Yes. Why?
QBR is a discount PBR.
Oh. Okay.
I thought PBR was already properly discounted, but.
Apparently not.
Well, thank you for the follow. And Derek Boberic, thank you for the 14 total bits. You say 3 bits for the rare Lions running back depth. Okay, fair enough. And then 11 bits. Do we have enough credits to land a proven OC now? Here's the problem. Who? How often is there just a proven offensive coordinator just waiting in the wings? Is my question. Because the only times that is true is college, and there's obviously, I mean, I everyone wants Joe Brady, right? Like Joe Brady, I feel like is the big name, but Panthers offense did not look particularly good with him. Panthers, is that right?
Yeah.
And I don't know, like he has the Saints background, and so I'm not going to rule it out at all. I think it's certainly a possibility, but, much easier said than done, I guess, is my answer to that. Jim Bob? What? All right, relax, chat. We need to get into this last segment, and I need to prepare myself because we're going to talk some Jaguars and Texans football, and I need to pull up their schedule.
Oh, Sunday night.
How sad things have become that we're talking about the Houston Texans and Jacksonville Jaguars.
You know, things could always be worse. The Lions could have Urban Meyer as their head coach.
That's going to sneak into this conversation, right? Did you see the tweet that I tweeted out about fan confidence in all three teams at the bottom of the standings?
Yeah, that was
kind of amazing, right?
That was pretty good.
Hey, don't get us in trouble.
I'm not.
Don't watch football while we're podcasting.
I'm definitely going to have this game up while we're podcasting.
All right, I'm going to do it too. I want to watch it too. I'm just being more professional.
A flag. God, that's going to happen during the last segment. I hope you're ready.
Legal hands to the... Legal hands to the face. Which team was it? I don't know what team's going that way. Oh, automatic first down. Oh, how does it feel, Packers? An automatic first down on an illegal hands to the face?
Shut up.
Oh, wow. That was actually a very aggressive illegal hands to the face. Anyways.
That was definitely warranted.
The tweet was, you know, if you follow Pride of Detroit, the website, sometimes we do something called a NFL Reacts. Last year was called Fan Pulse, where we poll a certain segment of our audience and say, are you confident in the direction of the team? And I pulled the results from last week for the Lions, the Texans, and the Jaguars fan bases. The Jaguars fan base had a 0% confident rate. 0% of the people in their poll were confident that the team is headed in the right direction. The Texans were 9%. Nine. The Lions, 88%. 88%. Despite
sitting
having a worse record.
Sitting at 110-1.
110-1.
We should definitely talk about this on the podcast.
Okay, fine. All right. Give me a second. We'll get back into it.
Move them back.
All right, shut up. Oh, Jason Peters, the locker room. That's not good. And we are back here on the PODcast, recapping Lions-Broncos. Final segment here. I think we're going to move on from the game. We kind of, like I said, want to turn the page on that one. Not a lot to take from it when there's so many backups playing in that one. But let's move forward. Let's talk about what Week 14 means for the Lions, because after the Lions win last week, suddenly their grasp on that number one pick is only half a game. They got a half game lead on the Jaguars and the Texans. Unfortunately for Detroit, they also lost both of those teams, and neither game was particularly close. The Jaguars were skunked, did not score a single point this week, and while the Texans were able to hang around a little bit with the Seahawks, in the end, they did not. And so Lions got four games left. They've got Cardinals next week. They've got, oh boy, testing my own memory here.
Well, I mean, real quick, we can pause on that because right now the Lions have opened up as 13.5-point home underdogs.
Yes.
To the Cardinals.
So their two most winnable games come after that, which is at the Falcons, at the Seahawks. Seahawks are kind of playing pretty well right now. The Falcons also won today, so both those teams are looking better maybe than they did a few weeks ago, and then they finish at home with the Packers, who might be fighting for a one seed. They might not be fighting for anything, but maybe one more win for the Lions. Probably not more than that. And so the problem, though, is that one win could potentially push them down, at least out of the number one spot. The good news for Detroit is that one of the teams that they're contending with, the Jacksonville Jaguars or the Houston Texans, are likely going to lose next week unless there's a tie, which could also kind of help the Lions a little bit. But I think it would be the least ideal situation. The question here is, with the Jacksonville Jaguars and the Houston Texans playing next week, who do you want to lose? Who do you want to get that loss, and who do you want to get that win? Because obviously I think you want the team that has the harder schedule to win because they're less likely to get one down the stretch. Do you have a preference here? Do you want me to go through each team's schedule?
I have a preference, but I think we should probably break down their schedules. Yeah.
Okay. So the Jaguars have the Texans next week at home. Then they go on the road at the Jets, a potentially winnable game. The Jets only have 3 wins. On the road against the Patriots, at home against the Colts to finish up. Colts probably going to be in the playoff race there. So that's, you look at that and you say the next 2 weeks are winnable for Jacksonville. The other two probably not. Fair?
Very fair. Especially when you talk about a Patriots team that's probably going to be fighting. I don't know.
They might have the one seed rolled up with the way they're playing.
I was going to say the Bills just lost. So, I mean, it feels like the AFC East is theirs to lose at this point.
For sure. Texans, on the other hand, they got the Jaguars on the road next week. Then they got Chargers at 49ers, home against the Titans. Seems like it would take a pretty significant upset for them to get a win out of any of those final 3 games. But, you know, the Chargers are pretty inconsistent. Actually, all 3 of those teams are kind of inconsistent, so I wouldn't completely rule it out. But it seems like this next week is the only one that they're going to be even close to favored in, right?
Yeah, and with that being said, I absolutely want the Jaguars to win.
Really? Okay, explain to me.
I absolutely want the Jaguars to win. And the reason why I want the Jaguars to win is because Urban Meyer. Like, I just because I that want
team
them...
is, that team is more likely to quit on everyone.
Yes. Precisely for that reason. Like, I think that if the Jaguars can get a win, maybe you can hope that the Texans squeak out a win against, you know, either the Chargers, the 49ers, or the Titans.
Sure.
Maybe they end up winning those games. Maybe because, you know, the Titans picked up that big win today over the Jaguars. Maybe the Titans are locked into the AFC South. They've won their division. Maybe they can't really improve their seeding or anything like that. Maybe they take the week off, you know. I would rather kind of bank on that than the Texans winning, because I know here's where it kind of the fork in the road comes, is that if you want the Texans to win, that means, hey, you think the Jaguars stand a chance of beating the Jets.
Right.
Like, I want the Jets to beat the Jaguars just to, like, lock the Lions into a top 3 pick.
Well, okay. I guess that's fair, but to me, the only way the Lions catch the Jets or vice versa, however you want to say, is if the Lions win 2 more games, right? Like, they've got a 1.5 game lead on the Jets with the Jets at 3 wins, the Lions at 1.5. So the Lions would have to win 2. So you'd be giving them both the Falcons and the Seahawks game, essentially. I don't think that's happening.
If the Packers can get their shit together and beat the Bears on Sunday Night Football,
all right,
here.
All right, relax, Mr. Parlay.
I understand where you're going with this.
It's an interesting point, though, like, because, yeah, the Jaguars have all the feels right now, and maybe by the time you're listening to this podcast, Urban Meyer might be gone. And if that's the case, maybe they get the bevel bounce.
The bevel bounce.
It worked for the Lions for 1 game, right? Didn't they get 1 win? Did they get 1 win immediately after? And then like, after that, it was a disaster. Maybe they get the bevel bounce against the Texans this week. I don't know. But, yeah, I don't know. It's hard because I'm at the same time, like, I don't know. Maybe what is it? Sahir Khan? Is that his name? Sahir Khan, the owner there. Like, if you hired Urban Meyer knowing all of the things about him beforehand, like, how is anything that's happening surprising to you? Maybe you're of the ilk of these kind of fans that hung around during the Matt Patricia era, where you're like, this sort of disruption is what was needed. We need to get all the bad eggs that didn't take this seriously. All the losers, get all the losers out. Because I'm not a loser. You coaches are the losers. Get all those guys out, and then you'll turn it around. Like, we know being on the other side of that doesn't work, of course. But,
right.
You know, maybe that's what the owner sees, and he rides Urban Meyer out the rest of the season. And if that's the case, yeah, I could see them lose out 100%. I could see them lose to the Texans, Jets, Patriots, and Colts. Yes. So maybe you want them to pick up a win here, but I mean, I don't want the Texans. I feel like you have to root for the Texans here because they just don't have another win here. They just don't have another win on their schedule.
But I think for the sure. Texans have been the most I think
the close,
it feels weird. It feels weird to say this, but it feels like they've been the more competitive football team. Like, and I know that's really weird to say about a team that lost 31-5 to the Cardinals and lost 31-3 to the Colts and got skunked 40-0 by the Bills.
31-0 to the Colts 2 weeks ago, a week ago. They did beat the Titans though.
And the Texans also beat the Jaguars earlier in the season.
They did.
In week one.
Yep.
And the Patriots barely beat them 25-22. I don't know. Like,
so your argument is that you think the Texans are better, so therefore more likely to steal a game.
Yeah. Like, I think that, like, if Davis Mills played today, but, like, if Tyrod Taylor plays, like, I mean, Tyrod Taylor can maybe win, can... He might be able to steal you a game.
If
right?
he plays.
If he plays.
They benched him today. No, they said they didn't they make an announcement that I think they made an announcement that what I don't even know the guy's name. What's Mills?
He's
gonna be
Mills?
The quarterback for the rest of the season.
What a trash franchise.
And that leads me to my other point that I wanted to talk about because I tweeted about this the other night. So the Lions, the Texans, and the Jaguars are the worst teams in the league. I think we can pretty much all agree with that in terms of just how they are in 2021. But you couldn't find a more different set of fans than the Lions that separates them from that group. And it's not just the Lions. Like, Texans are a mess. They have been a mess for a while, certainly since all the quarterback stuff happened last year and their owner and Bill O'Brien and all sorts of crazy stuff going on with that organization. Obviously, the Jaguars are an absolute mess under Urban Meyer, and everyone saw it coming. And we'll see if they make a coaching change after and make it a one and done, or if he doesn't even get to one and done. But the point I wanted to make was every week at Pride of Detroit, we send an email to a select amount of our fans, and every SB Nation site does this, asking them how confident you are in the direction of your franchise that you're a fan of. And they spit out a percentage every week just to kind of get a sense of where everyone's at. The Jaguars are currently at 0%, and that was before getting skunked today on Sunday. The Houston Texans are at 9%. Nine. As in under 10%. 90, not 19, 9.
That's a single digit.
The Detroit Lions, coming off their first win of the season, 88%. And listen, like, make all the jokes you want about the Lions accepting mediocrity and Lions fans being delusional and all that sort of jibber-jabber, because that's true of every franchise. Like, you look at the Jaguars poll, at the beginning of the year, they were at 90% as well. Like, that's just how fandom works when you start anew with a new coach, unless you're the Texans, because the Texans were obviously going through a lot of different things at the beginning of the year. They started at about 10% and never really got above 50. But I think the point being, the Lions are in a much better situation than these two franchises, right? Like, they have a team that likes playing for their head coach. They're playing hard. They've got resources to turn things around. Like, there's reason why there's an 80% difference than these other teams, right?
Right. I mean, at least the Lions fans feel like they have their head coach.
Right.
You know what I mean? For you know.
And it may be delusion. Like, there's certainly been some red flags with Dan Campbell. He's not a perfect. He doesn't. I don't think he warrants an 88% confidence in him quite yet. But he also hasn't done anything tremendously bad to lose complete faith in
him. I mean, he hasn't had an expose written about him that completely paints him as the most toxic person within the organization.
Right.
Questioning the resumes of his assistant coaches
who hired those guys, by the way.
Dude, it's wild. Like, Urban Meyer, I mean, but and that's not even the crazy. I don't even think that's the craziest thing that Urban Meyer has done all season long.
No, it might not be top three.
Like, he stayed back in Ohio to, like, grind on people. Like, like, Urban Meyer
tried to hire a guy who had just been accused of racism in college. Remember that story? Like, that was like 10 months ago.
I forgot about that, but that was forever ago.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Urban Meyer, not a great head coach. Also, Trevor Lawrence threw 4 interceptions today.
Right? And I saw some people, like, I was making the argument that, you know, the Lions are in a better shape than these two franchises, and people made a fair point that saying Trevor Lawrence, they got their, at least they have their franchise quarterback there, but he's not playing particularly well. That doesn't mean he's a bad quarterback. Rookies struggle in their first year all the time. Peyton Manning had blah, blah, blah interceptions, and everyone throws out that stat every time there's a potentially good quarterback that struggles at the beginning of their career. But my point being, like, do we know that they have their quarterback yet? I think the answer is no. I'm not saying I know that they don't have their quarterback. I think we just don't know yet.
Yeah, and that brings up an interesting conversation that maybe we can maybe we can follow up with this here in a second. But, like, if we want to take it to the Texans, I mean, this is an organization that, like, nobody wanted to be the coach of this football team.
Nope.
Nobody. Nobody wanted any part of this football team because of what's going on with Deshaun Watson, because of just the hierarchy within this organization in terms of ownership. And, I mean, you want to talk about, like, toxic ownership. I mean, that's the Houston Texans to a T.
They're doing everything the wrong way, man. And they're not treating their employees the right way, and all that sort of stuff. And it's a lot of the stuff that the Lions were guilty of 5 years ago, 3 years ago, 2 years
ago. Yeah, and I mean, just rewind the clock back, like, a year and a half ago. Like, the Cardinals, or I'm sorry, the Texans were an organization that traded away perhaps their franchise's greatest player for a running back.
Yeah.
Like, do you know, like, could you imagine, Jeremy, like, if the Lions had, like, traded Calvin Johnson for a running back who used to be good?
Le'Veon Bell.
But that's the thing. It's like David Johnson wasn't even David Johnson anymore. Right. Like, David Johnson was, like, the remnants of David Johnson.
Yep.
So, I mean, the Texans have just, and I mean, the with the whole way that the J.J. Watt saga ended, like, I mean, talk about an organization that has just, like, continue to just fumble every opportunity to get things right.
And then if the Jaguars are a team that is capable of hiring Urban Meyer when everyone knew that was going to be a disaster, their organization must not be pretty, you know, running pretty smoothly anyways. But I want to bring it back to the original point, which is my original point is I feel like the Lions are pretty much locked into a top two pick at this point, because the only way that really happens is if they win two
games, right?
They go 2-2 in their final four games, which maybe they pull one of those Atlanta Seattle games, but I don't see them winning any other two. They might be competitive. I mean, we've seen them competitive, and who knows, maybe something bounces the right way, but I think it'd be ridiculous for them to go to 2-2. And if they win one, because the Jaguars and the Texans play each other, one of those teams is going to pick up another win unless they tie again, which is kind of a disaster scenario. Lions are going to get a top two pick, which means If draft narrative continues the way it is, Thibodeau or Hutchinson, they're gonna have a crack at one of those two guys, which is, it's good news, because I haven't seen, like, a good edge rushing snap out of this Lions defense in 10 months, it feels like.
Since Romeo Okoro went on IR?
Pretty much, yeah, exactly.
Yeah, unless it's Charles Harris, and it's like, Charles Harris, go get the quarterback.
Right. He's you know what? That wasn't fair to Charles Harris.
That was not fair to Charles Harris. But, I think that's most accurate of where the Lions are, you know, heading down the stretch, is that, you know, either the Jaguars or the Texans are going to win next week.
Yep.
And that's going to lock the Lions likely into one of the top two picks. I think that the only thing that could end up being disastrous is if the Lions don't get one of those top two picks.
Right. That's how I feel too. Like, I feel like I need assurance that they're going to be one or two, and then I'm fine. Like, the Lions are going to get a top tier player, I think, at two, three. I mean, we were starting to have the Kyle Hamilton debate already, but I don't think we're going to have that debate anymore.
So, I mean, real quick. And this might be a conversation that we have continuously throughout, you know, the next five months. Oh my God. but I think this is a worthwhile conversation to at least bring up. But like you talked about the Jacksonville Jaguars. Yeah, they drafted Trevor Lawrence, who was viewed as probably being like one of the most like surefire number one picks in recent memory. Like you go back like to Andrew Luck and you're like, yeah, that guy 100% should have been the number one pick. It was the same thing with Trevor Lawrence.
Right.
You know, Trevor has really struggled in his rookie season. Would you be okay with the Lions taking a flyer on either a guy with the Rams pick or the Lions pick at the top of the second round, and then following up the next season, if the Lions have another bad season, drafting another quarterback like in the top five?
It's an interesting discussion. I think it's a little excessive. I think when you have these top picks and you need to get production out of them, in my opinion. Like
you can't have a miss.
You can't have a miss. And so you're essentially hedging your bet, right? Which you think I'd probably be a big fan of because I always hedge my bets.
Yeah.
But in essence, you are taking, you know, you essentially are going to have five picks over the next 2 years in the top 33. Mm-hmm. And you're essentially taking that down to four, right?
Yeah, right.
Which seems like bad strategy to me. Like I understand hedging your bets. I know making sure you get a quarterback is important and you know, paramount, really. Like it's goal number one, so I can see the argument for it, but I don't like wasting a pick necessarily. I feel like you just need to get a guy that you're sure of, and you don't mess around. You don't say, well, maybe this is our guy, but we're going to make sure next year that we do hit, like, one of these two guys is going to be our guy. No, just get your guy. Just get your guy.
Yeah.
I know you're distracted right now, and I know you are. I know exactly why. So I'm going to change to one last topic before we go, and that is the Rams pick, because we've got a big game on Monday night, and I know some of you are probably going to be listening to this after the Monday night game, but it's a huge game because the Rams are playing the Cardinals. If the Cardinals win this game, I don't know if they mathematically win the NFC West, but they essentially win the NFC West because they have a three-game lead over the Rams plus the tiebreaker. So I feel like unless maybe the 49ers can mathematically catch them, it's basically over. And so that's big news for the Lions pick because that means the Rams are going to essentially be a wild card team. At this point, I don't think it's realistic to expect the Rams to fall out of the playoff race completely. I think they're like 91% chance of making it to the playoffs. So as much as you want to hope that that's going to happen, it's not going to happen. The Rams are going to make the playoffs. There's not enough good teams in the NFC to push them out. But a win by the Cardinals on Saturday and Monday basically means the Rams will be traveling on the road for week one of the playoffs, which I guess, let me ask you this. Who is your ideal matchup? And in this scenario, we're rooting for the Rams to lose. I know there are a lot of Stafford fans out there, including me, that want to prove that Stafford can win big games. But let's just talk draft pick here. You want the Rams to lose. Who do you want to see them playing in round one of the playoffs? So right now the Cardinals are the one seed. They get a bye, theoretically, if they stay there. The other division winners are the Bucks, the Packers, and the Cowboys, assuming those all stand. Out of those three, who do you want to see the Rams in the first round to maximize Lions' draft pick?
You know, I feel like it just has to be the Buccaneers, right? Yeah. Because it seems like they're the most complete team, especially when they're at that full health. And, you know, even today, like they, you know, still without Antonio Brown, who I think is so important to their team. But I mean, they ended up pulling it out over the Bills in overtime fashion. But the Cowboys, here's the thing about the Cowboys that I think is kind of interesting, though. It's like
Stafford gets his revenge on the Cowboys.
Their defense is finally like healthy. True. Like they got DeMarcus Lawrence back. Micah Parsons has been an incredible. I mean, he's making a case for defensive player of the year, not just rookie defensive player of the year, but you know, their defense is finally getting back to full health, just like at the end of the season too. So really, I would feel good about them playing really any of those teams. Packers, I mean, we just watched the Packers take it to the Rams not too long ago. So,
and currently get it taken to them on Sunday Night Football. But you know what? The Packers in the not-so-distant past have gone into halftime losing to the Bears and absolutely crushing their dreams in the second half. So maybe that'll happen, Ryan.
I'm done.
You know what? I think we'll probably end it there. Thank you all for listening to the Pride of Detroit podcast. I want to remind you guys, please, if you can and haven't already, go to Apple Podcasts, give us a review so that we can maintain our status as the most, not highest, the most reviewed Lions podcast out there. And we'll read some. If you leave something entertaining there, we'll read you and you'll be famous for a day here on the Pride of Detroit podcast. But thank you for listening. Thank you to Ryan for joining us. Thank you to Chris for editing. We'll see you next week, hopefully, buddy. And until next time, it's chaos. Be kind.